It's true. You actually do not need sugar to live. How can that be? I thought sugar was a carbohydrate and we need carbohydrates to live. Let's discuss. There are three macronutrients. We have fat, we have protein, and we have carbohydrates. Carbs are made of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Most people eat mostly carbs, then fat, then protein. We live in a world with all sorts of conflicting nutrition advice, and carbohydrates are at the front and center of that controversy. So we need to start with what is indisputable, the facts, the actual science. And for most people on the planet who are not experts in understanding the scientific studies and statistics and so forth, it's easy for people to be led astray, and they can believe in things that are just simply not true.
You can't handle the truth!
So let's break down the complexities of the science and serve that on a nice platter, nice and easy for you to digest. Not all carbohydrates or all carbohydrate-rich foods are equal. They're not equal in terms of how the body uses them. So some are good, some are bad, and then some are in between. There's different types of carbohydrates that do different things. There's differences in how they're digested and absorbed and how they're used by the body. Now, this is a molecule called glucose. It's a carbohydrate, meaning it's a string of carbon that is hydrated with hydrogen and oxygen. And when it forms a ring-like structure, it's classified as a monosaccharide, meaning one sugar. Other monosaccharides are fructose and galactose. When you put two monosaccharides together, you get a disaccharide. For example, when you bite into an apple, this is the main sugar that you're eating. You're eating that disaccharide called sucrose, which is made of glucose and fructose. Sucrose is a type of simple carbohydrate called sugar. Specifically, sucrose is a disaccharide, meaning it's made of two monosaccharides. So in the case of sucrose, it's made of monosaccharide glucose and monosaccharide fructose. Other disaccharides include maltose, which is two glucose molecules fused together. And another example would be lactose, which is glucose and galactose fused together. Individual sugar units can combine into much more complex, often branched structures called polysaccharides, which typically consist of hundreds or even thousands of glucose molecules fused together. These carbohydrates are found in grains and vegetables and can be broadly categorized into digestible and indigestible types. Digestible polysaccharides, those include starch and glycogen. Now, starch is the storage form of glucose found in plant tissues, and glycogen is the storage form of glucose in the muscle and liver in both humans and animals. But a fun fact about glycogen, when you eat meat, you don't actually consume that glycogen because it's already been broken down when the animal died. Now, indigestible polysaccharides mostly consist of fiber, which only comes from plants. Cellulose is an example of a fiber that is composed entirely of glucose molecules. But unlike the glucose that's found in starch or glycogen, the glucose molecules that are in cellulose, those are fused together in a special way that makes it impossible for our gut enzymes to break them down. So certain foods contain two types of fiber. There's insoluble fiber, which is a type of polysaccharide that cannot be broken down by our body, and it can't be absorbed into your bloodstream. So it provides zero calories to you. And this actually passes unchanged through our digestive tracts, and I'll explain that later why this is so important. Now, the other fiber is soluble fiber. This fiber actually dissolves during digestion and it turns into a gel-like substance. It's not digestible, just like insoluble fiber is not digestible, but some components of it can be broken down by our gut bacteria that's in the colon, and what those bacteria do with it becomes very important. For example, soluble fiber is metabolized by the gut bacteria into short-chain fatty acids, one of those being butyrate, which gets absorbed into the bloodstream. And that's great because butyrate has anti-inflammatory properties. But let's for a second say you eat a carrot, which is, yeah, it contains fiber, but also contains starch. You're crunching on that carrot and the saliva in your mouth, it starts to break down that starch molecule, or all those starch molecules, into smaller and smaller starch molecules. And that's because of an enzyme in your mouth or in the saliva called salivary amylase. This is why if you eat a cracker and you chew on it long enough before swallowing, it tastes sweet on your tongue because that starch is getting broken down into the very small disaccharide maltose. Now, once that chewed up carrot reaches your stomach, it comes into contact with the stomach acid, which deactivates the salivary amylase enzyme that is mixed in with those little carrot chunks. Then it makes its way to the first section of your small intestine called the duodenum. Most of the starch is broken down into the disaccharides maltose there, Why? Because the pancreas secretes an enzyme called pancreatic amylase. Now, you also have other enzymes located in the small intestine that break down those disaccharides into sugar's most simplest form, monosaccharides, mainly glucose and fructose. And if you consume lactose in milk, that's going to be broken down into galactose and glucose. So the monosaccharides get absorbed from the intestine into the blood, which immediately goes to your liver by way of your portal vein. The liver will convert fructose and galactose into glucose. In fact, the body doesn't actually need fructose to live. So when fructose is dumped into your liver from that food you just ate, it says, well, I have to do something about it. So I'll turn that into glucose. And when there's too much of that, that's when it ends up being stored as fat. Glycogen as well, I'll get to that in a little bit. And unfortunately, at least from this perspective, the human body is very efficient when it comes to absorbing sugars. The body uses glucose to provide energy for all sorts of functions. And that's why the body carefully monitors blood glucose levels. It's called glucose homeostasis. And it's controlled by the pancreas and the liver. Now, when it comes to controlling blood glucose levels, the pancreas secretes two very important hormones, insulin and glucagon. When blood glucose levels increase, such as after eating carbohydrates, the insulin is released from the pancreas. Now, insulin lowers that blood glucose by stimulating the uptake of glucose by tissues, including the process of converting extra glucose into glycogen in the liver and in your muscles. What about when blood glucose levels are low? Well, what happens? The pancreas starts to secrete glucagon, which has the complete opposite effects of insulin. It's going to raise blood glucose levels. This includes breaking up that glycogen in order to free up more glucose. Remember, you don't actually need sugar to live. Carbohydrates other than sugar, yes, but not sugar. So what happens when you do eat it? Not only does it get converted to glycogen, it also gets converted to fat, another form of energy storage. The carbohydrates that exist in your body at the cellular level, the biochemical level, they have other functions besides serving as fuel for your body. Like they also form structural components of DNA and RNA. They can also be converted into materials for other structures too, like when the fragments are used as building blocks of amino acids. Remember, proteins are composed of amino acids. When sugar attaches to the protein molecule, it actually alters the properties of those proteins, changing the way that that glycoprotein functions. For example, let's say you have a cold or bronchitis or pneumonia or the flu and you start coughing up all this nasty crap and it's this thick, slimy, slippery grime. That's the work of glycoproteins. But by far, the biggest role for carbohydrates is fuel for your body. But in order to turn that carbohydrate into fuel and to use that fuel as energy, you have to inhale oxygen in order to burn that fuel. And then you exhale carbon dioxide, which is like the exhaust fumes coming from the body. So you burn these carbohydrates, right? And at the biochemical level, their bonds are exploding and they release energy. And that energy is used to make the molecule ATP. Now, ATP is the energy molecule of your body. That's the molecule that allows your heart to pump, your muscles to move, and for your brain to work, all that good stuff. Carbohydrates are found in all sorts of food. It can come in both good and bad forms. It comes in the form of whole intact grains, fruits, vegetables, legumes, and in dairy, things like milk, yogurt, and cheese. It can also come in the form of added sugar and refined grains. When you look at the nutrition facts label, you'll see a list of ingredients there, including carbohydrates. And under carbohydrates, you'll see fiber and added sugar. You can have all sorts of ingredients that are sugars that come in different forms. For example, high fructose corn syrup, molasses, honey, dextrose, and many more. All in all, there are 262 names for different sugars. Now, ingredients, they're supposed to be listed in order of their weight, starting with the heaviest and then down to the smallest. Now, for many foods, you'll often see that sugar ends up being the dominant ingredient, even though it's not the first ingredient listed. Why? Because the food labels intentionally break it up into many different forms of sugar so that it seems like sugar is not the main ingredient. But when you add them all together, oftentimes sugar ends up being the main ingredient for many food products. So for example, let's take a look at Honey Nut Cheerios, supposed to be healthy for you, right? Not so fast, because added sugar is far from healthy. Per serving, there are a total of 30 grams of carbohydrates, and 12 of those grams are added sugar. Notice that the first ingredient listed is whole grain oats and then oat bran. Good. But then keep going down the list and you see honey and brown sugar syrup, which are the added sugars. Of course, if you're dealing with fruits or vegetables, you don't have an ingredient label, because those are not packaged processed food. They're mainly carbs, either in the form of sucrose, glucose, and starch, in addition to the fiber that they have. So the healthiest carbohydrates to eat are the unprocessed or minimally processed things like whole intact grains, steel-cut oats, quinoa, fruits, vegetables, legumes, aka pulses. Technically, quinoa is a seed, but let's roll with it. Generally speaking, the recommended amount of carbohydrates people should eat in a day for optimal health is anywhere from 25 to 60% of calories. But it does depend on different factors, especially the type of carbohydrates that you're eating. But specifically added sugar, how much added sugar should be in someone's diet? Now, in the US, the average person consumes about 100 grams of added sugar per day, way more than what we should be consuming. Ideally, it would be as close to zero as possible, but most adults would be fine if they ate less than 30 grams per day, and for children, less than 10 grams per day. Most people truly don't realize how much added sugar they're actually consuming because it's hidden in the ingredients. It could be in barbecue sauce, ketchup, all these sorts of things, even salad dressing. Now, what about the keto diet? A lot of people want to know about that, especially because it can be helpful for those with seizures and for improving or even reversing type 2 diabetes, and of course, for weight loss. The keto diet entails eating less than 20% of the calories from carbohydrates, or about 20 to 50 grams of carbohydrates per day. There's a lot of things that you should be aware of with the keto diet. For one, you don't want your blood pH to be too acidic, meaning too low, for too long of a time. And it's actually hard to sustain that for more than 2 months. Also, for ideal health, you want to consume mostly unprocessed or minimally processed foods. So this means no bacon or sausage or hot dogs if you're doing keto. And you need to find a way to eat real foods that have both soluble and insoluble fiber, things like avocado, seeds, and nuts. People who stay on a keto diet for too long, they tend to be low in selenium, magnesium, phosphorus, and vitamin B and vitamin C, unless they eat foods that have leafy greens, things like spinach, kale. But getting back to sugar, ideally, if you're gonna eat sugar, it's best to eat it in the form of whole fruit and not from anything that contains added sugar. Remember, you don't actually need sugar to live, and too much causes all sorts of health issues, and it also ages you faster.